Blackstone Audio presents A Pinch of Poison by Claudia Bishop. This book is read by Justine Eyre. For Helen and Les, with love. Chapter 1. Margaret Quilliam flipped another page in the tabloid-sized newspaper, bolted upright, and shrieked.
My God! She shook her head. This is outrageous. Like discovering Martha Stewart's had a sex change operation, or that Julia Child binged on Twinkies. I can't believe I didn't take a look at this when it was published a week ago.
We've been busy, said Quill shortly. The new restaurant's taking up more time than I thought it would.
Yeah, but Quill, there's no excuse, with Doreen so annoyed with you.
Doreen is not annoyed with me.
She's annoyed at both of us, said Meg comfortably. Which is why she didn't let us know about this outrageous newspaper, I expect. I wish I'd gotten down to the diner for the gossip this week. It must be fierce. And by God, it says the next issue's due out today. I'll bet everyone's all of a doodah. Well, you needed a murder to solve. Sure as heck, somebody in town will knock this bozo off. Detecting will be good for you. It'll pull you right out of this depression you're in.
Sarah Quilliam ignored her sister, concentrating instead on the arriving guests list. She penciled query sashimi next to the names Sakura Kenji and Sakura Toshiro, then wondered where they'd find fresh fish. Ken Sakura taught art commentary at Cornell. Toshiro must be his father. She didn't really paint anymore, and it was too much to expect that someone like Ken Sakura had heard of her, but still. Sushi would be nice, a gesture. She dropped the list onto the wrought iron tabletop and sighed. Meg's comment about depression was an exaggeration, like her reaction to the newspaper. If she, Quill, was a little down, it was because it was Friday and the inn would be full by tomorrow. On the other hand, since a capacity crowd was unusual for the summer, it was probably the heat that was making her feel crosswise. It was hot, even for August. When the kitchen thermometer in the inn, the sisters owned together, hit 88, with a rise of 10 degrees forecast for the afternoon, they'd headed outside to the gazebo by the waterfall to finish their weekly meeting over menus and the guest list. Quill scanned the items on her written agenda. Review food to be served at their new boutique restaurant. Assess inventory process improvements. Verify menus and activities list for the upcoming week. Discuss special menu requests from the customer survey results. Meg wasn't going to like that last one. Quill sat back and sighed. Even her elbows were sticky from the muggy weather. The temperature had brought most of the inn's guests out onto the lawn. Temporarily abandoning special menu requests, which was Meg's job anyway, she wondered for the fourth or fifth time if they should air condition the building. The inn was situated high over Hemlock Gorge, and a breeze from the falls and the river usually cooled the inn from the ground floor to the eaves. The heat was intolerable only 2 weeks out of the summer. Maybe it wasn't as hot as it felt. Quill was wearing a light cotton skirt, sandals, and a flowered gauze blouse with full sleeves. Most of the guests had on less than that. Meg was in shorts, and she'd knotted her t-shirt above her waistband, but sweat trickled down her temples, and her face was flushed. Quill lifted her own mass of hair to let the breeze from the gorge cool her neck. It didn't work. It was as hot as it felt. She thought about the things she should be doing instead of sitting in the gazebo. She should grab the newspaper away from Meg and force her to plan her own bloody menus. And she should either talk to Mike, the groundskeeper, about deadheading the roses or do it herself. The heat had forced an early petal drop and things were looking shaggy. What she really wanted to do was go swimming in the clear water of the gorge and let the gardens, the inn, the menus, and the guest list take care of themselves. She looked at the building, the grounds, and the garden filled with people whose relationship to her was defined by the limits on their credit cards. She sighed. Meg was right. She was depressed, which was undoubtedly making her feel the heat even more. Quill tried to convince herself that the Adirondack chairs placed at strategic intervals throughout the gardens were filled with guests drawn irresistibly outside by the sound of the falls and the scent of the roses, and not the muggy temperatures. A large, elderly lady next to a 4-foot-high bush of apricot nectar fanned herself with a copy of Vogue. Her sigh of annoyance drifted accusingly across the lawn. Quill looked again at the estimate for air conditioning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.